Let me just say what an absolute honor it is to return here to the facility here in Clairton. Last time I was here, there was snow on the ground, and these brave union men and women were working through what was nothing short of an enormous mechanical failure. Could have been a catastrophe. Thankfully, no lives were lost and no one was hurt in that incident. And the men and women behind me responded in a manner so compelling and so professionally that that goal was achieved a full 6 months, or excuse me, 6 weeks before what was already an aggressive timeline to restore the systems after that catastrophic fire. I'd like to bring one of the union up to just to talk about that briefly.
Hello, folks. Well, the discussion we were having earlier here is just a little bit about what took place when the explosion took place, the fire, and how we handled the upgrade and recovery of the plant. And the key thing is for everybody to realize that there was a tremendous amount of manpower, people involved with this. We had literally hundreds of people involved working around the clock 24 hours a day, and we all understood what our mission was. The citizenry out here, the people in the community, they need to get this back up and running as well as U.S. Steel. We did it in a safe manner, total cooperative effort on all the parties involved, and we're happy to say that it worked out ahead of schedule and we got this thing back online. And I think it's important to also realize that it's not just the system put back as it was, it's better for everybody. Better for U.S. Steel, better for the community. So thank you.
He told me something that in 43 years?
43 years.
43 years, it was by far and away the most efficient, unified effort he'd ever been a part of or managed.
That is true.
Yep. And that's a testament. So
it is, yes.
Thank you. And, you know, it should come as a surprise to nobody that I'm absolutely 100% in support of clean air and a good environment. As I pointed out before, time and again, my own children live closer to a U.S. Steel facility in Allegheny County than anyone, or no, certainly no further than anyone else. We live right across the street from it. And I also had the option of living in a mansion in a bucolic part of Lebanon County with its own swimming pool. And I would never live there because I wanted to stay right here in the Mon Valley because this is my home. And steel should remain a part of the Mon Valley. And it has a mandate to do it in an environmentally safe and sound way. And that's what this whole visit was about. And when I, like the rest of you, I was concerned when there was another incident that caused the pollution control systems to shut down. And I called them up immediately and I said, what's going on? And they said, here's what it is. First of all, it involved something on the scale of the size of a small refrigerator. And it was an electrical malfunction. And I thought, wow, because again, I thought when I heard fire at Clairton, I thought it was another situation that was almost catastrophic like it was before. And it just wasn't the case. So the system went down. And my understanding is that thanks to the hard work of the union men and women behind me, that system was brought back online less than 12 hours after the event. And I'm all about facts. I'm all about the science. So I said, I want to go to the county health monitors and find out what happened during that period of time. Because I want my children to breathe clean air. I want to breathe clean air. I want everybody in these communities to breathe clean air. And that's exactly, and here's what the county air monitors showed. On the day of the fire, 617, the highest hourly reading was 25 parts per billion. Now that standard is 75. So at the height of this incident, the highest reading was just less than a third of what the standard should be. And throughout that whole week afterwards, there wasn't a reading that reached above that, less than around a third of what the standard is. And I know U.S. Steel is committed that we all breathe the cleanest air that is compatible with preserving the Union way of life for thousands and thousands of families. And I'm here to reemphasize how excited we are in Pennsylvania for the $1 billion plus investment in steel in this region. The greenest steel in the world will be produced in the Mon Valley, will be produced right across the street from where I'm raising my family, with union jobs, preserving the union way of life here in this region for another 40 to 50 years and beyond. And I think that's important. And I salute the agreement between the health department and U.S. Steel. And I'm incredibly grateful that the civil penalties that were granted, are 90% of those dollars are going to the very communities that deserve them. And I think that's another watershed moment as well, too. I don't ever want there to be a false choice between preserving and strengthening the union way of life here in the Mon Valley with clean air and the environment. And the facts after this last incident, I think, demonstrate U.S. Steel's commitment and the union's commitment to making sure that they have a world-class facility that provides the air at a radically lower level than what the standard of 75 parts per billion is. And I think it's important that we balance the necessity of steel from a national security perspective. We balance the 3,000 or more union jobs that these facilities support, and that we support a clean environment that works for everybody. And that's why I'm proud to be back here again to stand with these men and women who did an extraordinary job in the face of two instances which could have led to not only the loss of life, but also a catastrophic event with respects to the air quality. And thankfully, especially during this last incident that occurred, there wasn't one exceedance that even rose above one-third of the standard. And I'm proud to stand here with them, and I'll take any of your questions now.
Yes. Anyone with
U.S. Steel
here with you?
I'm sure.
We'll take questions.
Yeah. Well, again, I base it off the standards that was provided by the Health County monitors. And we need steel, and it needs to be produced in the most technologically advanced ways possible that keeps us at the forefront of the manufacturing process. And U.S. Steel's commitment to invest in over $1 billion does just that. And I think that anyone that would suggest otherwise, that we don't need steel or that somehow it can be produced in a technology that currently doesn't exist, if that technology ever does, it's going to be the folks and the union men and women that are going to develop that, and they're going to implement that. And we, so.
Follow-up question, do you think U.S. Steel could
be doing more? I think U.S. Steel has been responding to the set of circumstances in a manner that has done so that, again, air monitors don't lie. And I would say that they have always been committed to transparency with me, and they've been committed to transparency with working with the unions and preserving that way of life going forward. And if I ever believe that U.S. Steel can be do more or should do more, I'll be the first person on the phone to call them up and say, hey, we need to talk. The purpose is to just go over exactly where U.S. Steel is, where they're going forward, to affirm their commitment to invest in over $1 billion, including a multiple hundred millions of dollars investment in a cogeneration facility here in Clairton, and their ongoing commitment to an open dialogue that places environmental stewardship at the very top of their list, and their commitment to an open, transparent, and robust conversation with these following, with the surrounding communities. I'm not sure what you mean by problem. There was a catastrophic event.
Not the fire.
Yeah.
The agreement was over pollution violations over the course of 2018. And
my understanding, Bob, is that the air, and this is coming from the health department, the air's never been better than it was in 2018. And that's their word. That's the facts. That's the data. You know, that's not a subjective opinion. So, unless somebody can demonstrate to me otherwise, that wasn't the case. And it's only going to continue to get better and better. And even after a failure, in this last, on the 17th of June, you had air levels, the sulfur dioxide, less than a third of the standard, you know, at the height of this incident that knocked out those pollutant controls. That to me, in an objective scientific manner, demonstrates that U.S. Steel has been making good on their commitment to deliver the cleanest air, given the technological limitations of that making steel is a hot, dangerous, and powerful process. I can't speak to the Allegheny Health Department or their opinions or anything. All I do is talk about the facts from their monitoring equipment. And I talk to the fact that I believe that the union men and women that work here and work for U.S. Steel, and U.S. Steel is committed to an open, transparent conversation that places environmental stewardship at the top of their list of commitments. And the second I believe that there's evidence that that's not the case, then I'll be the first person to call them up or come down and say, I think there's a problem here. And I think it's important to hold somebody accountable. I think it's important also to acknowledge that given this last incident that caused a lot of consternation and concern in the media, let's look at what actually happened in terms of air quality, the response, and how the men and women responded, and the process going forward. I'd point out that not since the systems came online 6 weeks earlier than they were scheduled to, there hasn't been one single exceedance. And I believe they have a commitment to making sure that they do a good job and their environmental commitment is honored. And as I said, I'll know before most people because I live across the street from it. Again, hypotheticals. We're here to talk about what happened, and we're here to talking about actual data points, and that's what I'm talking about. You're right. Hypothetically, something could happen. Like, for example, in West Virginia, a coke mill was struck by lightning, and that triggered a fire. So can I control, no one can control, if there's a lightning strike. Something could happen, but what I can say is that I believe that the union men and women behind me and the management of U.S. Steel is committed to environmental stewardship moving forward. And I think the fact that they're investing over $1 billion in this region is reflective of that.
Do you think that the person with the $1 billion
Well, it unquestionably will make the air quality better. The air quality based on these monitor readings, as I said, was less than a third than what the standard is. And I know their goal is ultimately to have zero. You know, and like I said, if technologically that ever becomes possible, it will be these men and women that'll be at the vanguard of that, driving that innovation to do it going forward. You know, when this new facility goes online, it will literally be, my understanding, the greenest steel produced in the world. And I think that's an important statement, because you know what? That green steel will help our U.S. automakers deliver on the lower mileage standards that we need to reduce fuel consumption. That will guarantee thousands, tens of thousands of auto worker jobs, tens of thousands of steel worker jobs. And that's a technology. I'd like to point out that facilities from all over the world visit here to find out, how do you guys do it from an environmental standpoint? And it's never good enough in U.S. Steel in the union's eyes. You know, they'll always work to zero parts per billion. But until that day, they've demonstrated that they're keeping it below, well below the standard of 75 parts per billion. And the Allegheny County Health Department's own monitors routinely demonstrate that. Correct. I think it suggests that U.S. Steel is committed to recovering from what was virtually a catastrophic event. They came back online, and there hasn't been any violation since then. As that gentleman pointed out, it wasn't just repaired, it was improved and enhanced. And the hundreds of millions of dollars in investments here, I think, again, speaks to that as well, too. Yeah, I'm not here to say that there's never been a violation. I'm not here to say that. You know, what brought me here the first time was the response to that catastrophic event that occurred on Christmas Eve, and talking about the union's incredibly robust efforts to come back from that, and the success that's been as a result of that, and looking at the monitor results, and talking about the path forward that culminated in you were at the event, I saw you there, $1 billion-plus investment in the Mon Valley. I think that's an extraordinary statement. And let me just tell you, even though I've been in state government just a short, relatively long period, you know, billions, not millions, those don't happen every week or every month or every quarter. I just believe that it's important that we all work together to make sure that the environment and these communities are protected going forward. And as a resident of these communities, raising his family there, I'm proud to be a part of those efforts.